bigotry. Basically, as we look around the world today, almost everybody's taught some form of bigotry. Of course, it's vital that as children grow, that we teach them to make judgments. And children adapt to what they see, not to what they hear. Children watch and learn, and they take on the habits of their parents.
Go that way!
And gradually, almost everybody in some way teaches some type of bigotry, and this is wrong. How do we address this? Here we have a wonderful thing that happened here in the year 2012. A black president, Mr. Obama, ran on the basic idea that people are people. He started his campaign with a historical idea that gay rights are human rights, that gays are human. Because the other side and many other people believe that gays are not human. There's many people who believe that blacks are not human, Indians. There were people in Australia who believed that Aborigines are not really humans. And in the Olympics, they didn't think that the little girl who won so many gold medals, that she was actually human. We have to address this, and we have to look at the idea that human rights are human rights, and these people are humans. Reminds me of a story how in 1986 I was asked to come to Pakistan. I was asked by the president to come and to give an address on homeopathy. At the very, very first day when they took me into a room with 5,000 people, and I was the guest speaker, the keynote speaker. They said that all of the different people would be lecturing in English, and I listened to them as they all lectured in Urdu, the language of Pakistan. Finally, the Minister of Health leaned over and said the next address will be in English. The man got up and started lecturing in Urdu, and I leaned over and said, "That's very bad English." And he spit that he laughed so hard, and everybody looked. This was so prim and proper. Finally came my turn, and I was panicking. At the beginning of the lecture, at the very, very beginning, the holy man stood up, who was covered with animal skins, and he led us in an Urdu prayer, which I didn't understand. I didn't really understand in 1986, being naive and young, I didn't really understand exactly what religion this was. I got up and started lecturing on homeopathy, and everybody stood up and went crazy. I have to imagine this is 1986, the same time as Charles Wilson's War, the movie with Tom Hanks. That's the same time there was a war going on. Afghanistan, Soviet Union.
We want to draw attention.
Draw attention? This is the Cold War. Everybody knows about it. There must be some
kind of way. We're going to Israel next week, and we'd attack Pakistan on the end of your trip.
This meeting is going to be unprofessional.
A friend of mine is a belly dancer. While she's dancing for the defense minister, we'll be talking to his deputy.
Oh, my God.
She's supposed to be good.
This thing is going to get done by the CIA, and it's going to get done quietly.
You have authority to do this?
None whatsoever.
So bye-bye, Miss American Pie.
How is it possible that this congressman of no particular importance is doing this by himself?
And them good old boys were drinking whiskey and rye, singing, "This'll be the day that I die. This'll be the day that I die."
Where does this rank relative to other covert wars?
There's never been anything else like it.
And America was trying to decide which side to help finance, etc. Lots of turmoil, trouble. And the holy man led us in a prayer. And then it came my turn. And I remember being afraid and closing my eyes and seeing Professor Kingsfield from the paper chase saying, "Fill the room with your intelligence." And I talked about how homeopathy was the way of medicine in America, and how just after the Civil War, a very bloody conflict, there was more homeopathy schools in America than there were traditional medical schools. Homeopathy was flourishing. Thousand some odd people went to the allopathic schools with the type of flu that they got after the war. With so much stress and tension, the immune systems were weak and flu took over in a very large epidemic. 10,000 some odd people were treated in the allopathic hospitals. 98% of them died. 10,000 some odd people documented to have gone to the homeopathy hospitals for treatment. 99% of them lived. Homeopathy was working. As I gave this address in Pakistan, 5,000 people stood up and cheered. In fact, as I started telling story after story after story, they got up and gave me standing ovations over and over again for what I was saying, because homeopathy is the medicine of Pakistan. Only the rich, 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 the 1% at the top, really get the allopathic treatment. Homeopathy is the medicine of the people. As I started to tell more and more stories and got into it, finally I told the story of a friend of mine who was in the Baha'i. I told the people that there are two things that threaten life on this planet. One is the synthetic chemical companies, and two is judgmentalness. They are making synthetics, and at any day, at any time, they might make a synthetic that could end the human race. It is possible. In fact, it's becoming more and more probable that they will make some type of a compound or some type of a GMO that might end the human race. That's possible, and that's a threat. But a greater threat is that of judgmentalness. My friend in the Baha'i told me of a man in Iran who was Baha'i. The soldiers came, took him out of the house, put him on his knees in the front yard, asked him what he believed in, and because he believed in something different than what they did, they shot him in the head and turned to the wife and asked her to pay for the bullet. This type of judgmentalness in its extremity has to be stopped. And as I said this story, I looked up and recognized that now all the people did not stand up, because the people who did this in Iran were Islam, and my audience was an Islamic audience. Everybody glared, and there was silence. And I feared for my life. Just then, the holy man stood up. And he glared at me, and he walked to the center of the room. And he started to applaud. And all 5,000 people stood up and applauded. Best standing ovation of the day. He later told me that even though that they are Islamic, that he believed that that type of extremism, of judgmentalness, bigotry, is unnecessary. This is where we live in the world today. Now, how do we handle this? What do we do? How can we change this? How can we do something? We helped to elect Obama, and it was a really tight election, because there are so many people who don't want to let go of this bigotry, don't want to let go of judgmentalness. And that creates a big problem. A friend of mine from Ukraine had moved to Toronto, and she invited me to come. She says, well, now that she's come into money, she has a new house, big place. And she says, well, there's no niggers there. And I thought to myself, oh my God. I said, are you a bigot? She said, oh no. And I said, would you think I'm a bigot? And she's, oh, well, no. And I said, I'm sure that your neighbor across the street is angry because a Ukrainian moved in. How can we get through this? How can we start recognizing this? Because if we're going to tolerate intolerance, it's cowardice. We cannot tolerate intolerance. We have to do something about this. We have to stop this. This is very important. And every time there's a conversation like this, if people were to stop and say, wait a minute, do you understand the words coming out of your mouth? Do you understand the bigotry? And if everybody would just stop a little bit, and if we wouldn't tolerate intolerance, then we could help to end it. Now, we have to understand that toleration is not acceptance. We're not saying do we have to accept all these other ideas. We tolerate them, and there's a big difference. We don't have to absorb or take all those other ideas or etc. We need to tolerate them. And people who are intolerant, this is the source of bigotry. And we can't allow this to get into the extreme. Any extremist idea is a bad idea. So we have to be able to do something. And the bottom line is, every time that you're given any type of instance of bigotry, don't tolerate it. Don't tolerate bigotry. Draw the line and just say, excuse me, I don't like to talk to bigots on bigoted ideas. That's the place to start. Thank you, Desiré Dubounet. Thank you.